Hello, coders. So the next thing I'd like to do is add some visual indication for the light object. There are a variety of ways we could do this. We could render a spherical model using the pipeline we currently have, or more advanced methods might render light sources using some sort of post-processing effect. However, I would like to take this opportunity to add a second rendering system to the engine and to introduce a topic known as billboards. A billboard is a flat 2D object embedded in the 3D world, but has the additional property that it is always facing the camera. No matter how the camera moves or rotates, the billboard will always face the camera to some extent. It's like if someone's watching you, and no matter where you move or look, they turn to face you. Billboards can be used for a wide range of things, such as placing health bars above the heads of enemies, or for representing objects that don't have a physical opaque surface, things such as clouds, grass, smoke, or particles. There are a few variations on how exactly a billboard can work based on how it aligns itself to the view. Screen-aligned billboards align themselves to the camera's viewing plane. This means that the billboard's rotation is dependent on the camera's rotation, but not its positioning. An alternative method is viewpoint-oriented billboards. With this style of billboard, it will always orient itself to directly face the camera, and therefore is affected by both the rotation and position of the camera. There are even more options than just the two I mentioned here. Axis-aligned billboards are commonly used for displaying trees, or for example, variations displaying a fixed size regardless of distance. Definitely check out the additional resources provided for a more complete description of this topic. For this tutorial, though, we will be using screen-aligned billboards, as they are relatively simple to implement and work well for small, symmetrical objects like point lights. The billboard we create will be pinned to a single point in 3D world space and will have a width and height. Each vertex position of the billboard will be calculated in a vertex shader. This is accomplished by first starting at the center point and then displacing each vertex by the camera's up and right vector. This will create a flat object made up of two triangles always aligned to face the camera. Okay, let's get to coding. So, to render a billboard, we need to be able to extract the camera up and right vector in world space within the vertex shader. Currently, we have our projection and view matrix combined into one. So, in the app implementation, I'm going to separate these matrices. And then below in the render loop, set the UBO projection field to just the camera projection, and the UBO view field to the camera view. Now, because we've changed the format of our uniform buffer, we need to update the definitions in the simple shader files to match. In the vertex shader, I'll break the projection view matrix into projection and view fields. And we'll also change the calculation for the GL position value to use these separate matrices. Don't forget here that the matrix multiplication order matters, so you must have a projection times view and not the other way around. This is probably the last time I'll be mentioning this. I'll copy the updated UBO structure definition and navigate to my fragment shader to also update the definition there. So we haven't changed any of the program behavior. But as a quick sanity check, let's make sure that everything is still working as before. Build and run your program, making sure to recompile your shaders, but by now that should really be an automatic build step. Okay, so everything's still working. Now, to render the light source, we're going to need to create a second independent rendering system. Within my project source directory, I'm going to create a new folder called Systems. The build system we created in the previous tutorial should automatically detect any source code even within subdirectories. This will make structuring the project easy. As the tutorials continue, I'll reorganize the project bit by bit. For now, though, I'll just move the simple render system to the Systems folder. And then duplicate these files to act as a starting point for the new point light system. After renaming these two files, navigate to the point light system header and rename all occurrences of the class to point light system. I'm also going to change the render game objects function to just be called render, as I think this makes a bit more sense in this context. Now, for some reason, I had to close my VS Code project and reopen it to get the detection for my include paths to be properly picked up. I'm not sure as to why that was exactly. Probably something to do with creating the new folder, so just you may need to do that as well if you're using VS Code. Okay, now in the point light implementation, I need to update my initial include statement, and we can remove the push constant struct definition here as that's only relevant to our simple render system. And then replace each occurrence of simple render system with the new class's name. The constructor and destructor are both good as is. I'm going to just comment out the code for the push constant range. We don't have one yet, but in an upcoming tutorial, we will be adding this back in. So in the pipeline layout info, let's also update the push constant fields to use a count of 0 and a null pointer for the ranges. In the create pipeline function, we will be using new shader files specific to the system. So update the shader path files to use pointlight.vert and pointlight.frag. The render game objects function can be renamed to just render. And then we're still going to bind the system's pipeline and descriptor sets just as before. But all of this code for drawing model objects can now be removed. So we're going to use a similar trick to what we had when drawing your first triangle. To draw the light, we can use a single vk command draw function call that will draw 6 vertices. The billboard will be a square object made up of 2 triangles, so 3 vertices for the first triangle and 3 more for triangle number 2. The vertex positions will be hard-coded into the point light vertex file, as I'll demonstrate in just a moment. Now, in your shaders directory, create 2 new files for pointlight.vert and pointlight.frag. Starting with the vertex file, we'll specify the GLSL version being used as version 450. And then I've provided a pastebin link with the vertex position offsets that can be copied into here. These values will be used to create the billboard object by offsetting each vertex position from the point light's location in the X and Y camera space directions. Next, I'm going to declare a vertex shader output value at location 0, so we can access the linearly interpolated offset within the fragment shader. Following that, we have the same UBO struct definition as used by the simple render system shaders. For the engine, I'm structuring things so that the global UBO object will be the same for every shader we create. Where inputs can start to vary between shaders will be by adding additional shader-specific descriptor sets. Then, I'm going to declare a constant value specifying the size of the billboard object, called light radius. We can make this a push constant in a future tutorial, but for now we'll stick with just using a fixed value. Finally, we need to write the main function. To start, we set the frag offset output value. We're going to use the same trick as we did in the early tutorials by using the special variable glVertexIndex. This holds the index for the vertex currently being processed. Then, we need to extract the camera up and right vectors from the view matrix. These will be in world space. The 3 elements of the first row of the view matrix make up the camera right vector. And the first 3 elements of the second row make up the camera up vector. Using these, we can calculate the vertex position in world space. We start at a light position, which is already in world space, and then apply the X and Y offsets by the camera vectors. And as a last step, we compute the final GL position by applying the projection and view matrices to the position in world space. Before moving on, there are a couple things I'd like to point out. If you're concerned about the extra matrix multiplication we now need to perform, a possible optimization is to also pass in the pre-computed projection view matrix in the global UBO struct. But I don't think this would, at least currently, make any measurable performance difference. Next, there's an alternative method for computing the final position by applying the offsets to the position in camera space rather than doing the initial computation using the position in world space. It might be a good exercise to try and come up with that yourself. I really can't emphasize how beneficial it is for anyone working on computer graphics to gain a really good understanding of these transformations and sequence of spaces. I'll show the other possible solution after we get things compiling first. Okay, the fragment shader implementation is really easy. We specify the version of GLSL, then we need to declare the fragment shader input, so at location 0 we have the frag offset value. The output is the same as the simple shaders with a vec4 outcolor at location 0. Then we have the same global UBO struct, so copy and paste that in. And then finally, our main function is as simple as it gets. For now, we'll just set the outcolor to equal a vec4, with our light color and an opacity of 1. Okay, almost finished. In the first app implementation, I need to update the include statement to look into the systems directory, and I'll also include the point light system. Then below where we have the simple render system initialization, I'll also create a point light system. And in the render loop, I'll call point light system.render, passing in the frames information. And that's it. We can build and run. And now if you zoom a little back, you should be able to see the point light object being rendered. Note how as the camera rotates, the billboard always rotates to face the camera directly on. I think a circular light would look a lot better, and one way to do this easily is to discard any pixels that are outside the point light's radius. We can do this by using the frag offset input in the fragment shader. We first calculate the distance the fragment is offset from the light's position. Note that based on how we set up our offsets, the frag offset X and Y values will always be in the -1 to 1 range, no matter how large the billboard is made. So if the distance is greater than 1, we discard. Discard is a special word that can only be used within fragment shaders. It tells the pipeline to throw away this fragment and return. This means the out color will never be set for this fragment. If you run your code again, the light should now appear spherical. We can make the light object larger or smaller by changing the value of the light radius constant in the vertex shader. Now would also be a good time to try calculating the vertex positions using the alternative method I mentioned previously. And for those interested, here's my solution. Okay, this tutorial's already a bit longer than I would have liked, but there's one final thing I'd like to do, and that's to fix these validation layer messages. We're getting these warnings because the point light pipeline expects there to be the same vertex attributes that we use in the simple shader to be present. Any of the shader programs we create that require model objects will want to use these values, but that isn't really the case for the point light system. So before finishing today, I would like to make it so these values are optional. In the pipeline header file, I will adjust the pipeline config info struct to contain vector fields for both the binding descriptions and attribute descriptions. Then, when a pipeline is created, rather than fetching these values statically from the model class, we can use the values provided by the config info. I'll also mark these variables as references. This way we avoid causing an unnecessary vector copy operation. In the default pipeline config info, I'll set the default values for the binding and attribute descriptions to use the static values fetched from the model class. This way, the simple render system will continue to work without any additional changes. And using the model's value is what we will likely want in most cases. So I think they make sense as the default value. And finally, for the point light system, we need to tell it to not use these descriptions since it is a special case. So in the implementation of point light create pipeline, call the clear function on the pipeline config's attribute description and binding description vectors. If you run your code again, the validation error should now be gone. And we're finished. Stay tuned for the final few tutorials on point lights, which will be coming out soon. And thank you for watching. Keep on coding. Cheers.